For a planet just about the size of Earth, Venus couldn't be more different. One of the original planets known to the ancients, Venus is a common and very bright sight in the night sky, and in fact is the third brightest object in the sky. In fact, if you know exactly where to look, it can even be seen in full daylight. The history of observation of Venus stretches into prehistory worldwide, but there is a quirk in that. Due to Venus's movement, it actually appears discontinuous. It disappears when in close proximity to the sun. This is illusory, but it actually led some cultures, including the early ancient Greeks, to conclude that Venus was actually two objects, a morning and an evening star, and not the same object. Others did figure it out. The Babylonians recorded their conclusion that it was the same object on cylinder seals. The Babylonians had an interesting name for Venus that translates to Divine Lady of the Red Heavens, a reference to the color of the sky when Venus becomes easily visible at dusk and dawn. The scientific study of Venus also started early. In the 2nd century, Ptolemy rightly surmised that Venus and Mercury were located between the Earth and the Sun. Modern study, unsurprisingly, begins with Galileo and his telescope. He noticed that Venus shows phases, like the Moon, and thus he confirmed a sun-centric model. It had to be inside the orbit of Earth to show this prominently, as does Mercury. The 18th century saw the discovery of Venus's atmosphere through observing it scattering sunlight, though no one yet knew what that atmosphere was like. Past that, very little else was discovered about Venus until the 20th century. But when it started happening, it went very quickly. Spectroscopic observations revealed that Venus's rotation must be very slow, and ultraviolet observations in the 1920s revealed that Venus's atmosphere was not featureless, as it usually is in visible and infrared light. Astronomer Frank Ross was actually able to work out from these observations that Venus has a dense yellow atmosphere and a cloud deck, which was generally correct. Some in the early 20th century envisioned Venus as a steamy jungle world, bursting with life, but that was shown not to be the case when we actually went there. The first attempt was by the Soviet Union with Venera 1, which was the first interplanetary spaceflight, but the spacecraft went dark while it was en route. In 1962, Mariner 2 was successful, and the modern era of data collection on Venus began, and showed that it was a very different, very hellish world compared to anything else in the solar system. In many ways, though, Venus remains shrouded in mystery, mainly because it's shrouded in the densest atmosphere of all the terrestrial worlds in the solar system. At its surface, the pressure is an astonishing 92 atmospheres. This is actually enough to force the atmosphere at that level into a supercritical fluid state, somewhere between a gas state and a liquid state in properties. Venus is about the same size as Earth and appears to have significant evidence of volcanic activity on its surface that's probably still active, at least in some form. In the past, this can happen on large scales. Essentially, Venus would crack open and spew huge sheets of lava, resurfacing large parts of its surface. We don't know if it still can. Venus's atmosphere is mostly carbon dioxide with nitrogen and a permanent cloud deck dominated by sulfuric acid, which all causes a very severe greenhouse effect, giving a surface temperature on the order of 867 Fahrenheit or 464 degrees Celsius. Venus has a year of 224.7 days and a day that is 117 days long by Earth reckoning. Venus also rotates backwards from most other bodies in the solar system, and does it very slowly, and that's where the interesting weirdness of Venus begins. The only way for Venus to have ended up rotating this way is the effect of the dense atmosphere slowing and reversing its motion over time. Very dense but dynamic atmospheres can have strange effects indeed, but there are a number of outstanding mysteries regarding Venus. The first is known as the ashen light, which I myself have seen through a telescope. This phenomenon, if it's real, shows itself as a very dim glow from Venus's dark side when it's in the crescent phase. This phenomenon has been seen for a very long time. The first observation of it was recorded in 1638 and has sometimes been noted, but other times has not been seen, and no one's ever been able to confirm that it actually exists. Opinions have always varied on this. An observation from 1643, for example, led the observer to attribute it to optical effects inside his telescope. William Herschel reported it, and in a more modern context, Sir Patrick Moore. Yet at other times, very deliberate attempts to observe the ashen light have failed, especially during times when the moon has obscured Venus partially, just showing the dark side. Yet at other times, such as in my own sighting, it was very distinct. More importantly, however, a very subtle green glow was observed by the Keck telescope. Astronomers there speculated it might be due to ultraviolet from the sun splitting molecules of CO2 into carbon monoxide and oxygen, which then combines to form O2, which emits green light, but not nearly enough to account for what Keck saw. Yet smaller telescopes, observing at the same time, saw nothing, though that may have been due to it being very dim. Another option has to do with Venus's magnetic field. It has one, but not like Earth. It's incredibly weak, and instead of being produced internally within the planet, it is being induced by the solar wind and Venus's ionosphere reacting. That should allow in a lot more cosmic radiation than what Earth gets, and that might result in cloud-to-cloud lightning that might create a transient glow. Another option is some kind of auroral glow that's not like any of the other solar system's auroras. Adding to the mystery is that we know Venus has lightning, we just aren't sure how much. And if this effect is due to that, it's going to require a lot of lightning. Moreover, the Pioneer Venus spacecraft picked up some kind of bright air glow that might have been lightning related. Yet other spacecraft designed to look optically for lightning never saw it, suggesting that the lightning is too deep in the atmosphere to see from space. It's also been suggested that the ashen light, as seen visually through telescopes, is actually an optical illusion, a product of the brain, that comes about by observing a bright crescent and then the brain painting in a ghost. This may well explain my own sighting, for all I can say. It was visual, and I did not have a camera on hand to try to photograph it. But there's one last aspect. In 2012, a coronal mass ejection from the sun hit Venus, and during observation, lo and behold, a bright green emission line was seen. It's been seen since during these events, but not always after solar flares in general, suggesting it's a type of aurora, causing it linked to solar CMEs. But that's only where Venus's mysteries start. The next is far bigger and involves an odd fact about Venus. While its surface is not like Earth at all, there is a layer in the upper atmosphere that actually is about comparable in temperature and pressure to Earth at sea level. This has led to ideas of colonizing not the surface of Venus in the future, but its atmosphere through floating habitats and balloons. The advantage is that tearing your spacesuit in this layer of Venus's atmosphere wouldn't be a big deal, or almost certain death like most places in the solar system. This clement environment, however, brings up another possibility. Could Venus have microbial life? In principle, yes, and there are two ways for this to have happened. One is that it's life from elsewhere, Earth being a good candidate, that colonized Venus's atmosphere through panspermia. The other is that it might be native Venusian life that could have arisen during a hypothesized period where Venus may have had liquid water oceans and the same general conditions as Earth had when life arose here. The strange thing here is that there are multiple indications at Venus that may indicate something is going on in its upper atmosphere that may represent some kind of biology. Taken as a whole, these hints actually outdo similar hints at Mars and Europa. It's possible that Venus is the best candidate in the solar system for life beyond the Earth. The first indicator of this has been noted for over a century. Venus has dark streaks in its upper atmosphere visible in ultraviolet light that actually absorb UV more efficiently than the areas immediately surrounding them. And it's very pronounced, to the tune of 40% more absorption in a streak as opposed to the clouds directly next to it. There's no known mechanism for this, other than some unknown material doing it. Fair enough, some unidentified component of the cloud deck, but these streaks evolve and change anomalously, more like biology than the action of wind and cloud, and so far no chemical has been found associated with this phenomenon. It does, however, resemble, at least superficially, patterns that microbial life here on Earth do as far as blooming and moving. But that's not the only mystery here. By far, the most successful missions to Venus were those of the Soviet Union, which performed multiple landings on its surface. These missions detected elongated particles in the lower cloud layers of Venus of unknown composition. All they were able to determine is that they were about the size of a bacterium, and were elongated like some species of bacteria here on Earth. The problem is Earth bacteria could not survive in this environment, so it remains open just what those particles are. But there are ways to envision alternative biochemistries here that could work, but we have nothing like them here on watery Earth. The argument is often made that Venus has very little water, none on its surface and only trace amounts of water vapor in its atmosphere, but it does have liquid in the form of sulfuric acid. Recent work has shown that maybe sulfuric acid can be a solvent for life and be sustaining life in that cloud deck. One thing that's been advanced here is basically an armored microbe that shields itself with a sulfur-based molecule known as S8. S8 is a ring-shaped polymer that is resistant to sulfuric acid. And here's the kicker. It's been detected in the atmosphere of Venus from an unknown cause. A further mystery is the presence of phosphine gas detected at Venus. Few discoveries in planetary science of late have been as contentious as this one. The update here is that while the claim was called into question and subject to a prominent debunk here on YouTube, a debunk that got a lot of the science wrong, the detection has held up. The levels of phosphine are much lower than initially reported, but they are anomalous, present, and according to work done decades ago in the lab, is not being produced by lightning or any other known mechanisms. But while phosphine is a gas associated with biology, it is also a gas that nature can produce without biology. So it is only an indicator, as any of them are, that Venus may be a good place to search for microbial life independent of Earth. Venus is an alluring world to explore, indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently addressing the planet series I've been doing on this channel. You're actually seeing the result of my research habits. Each year, I review the science of each of the planets and moons, we'll get to those, to update my knowledge, so this year, I decided I would make that process into videos. I'm also currently glancing askew at Mars. You're next, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.